The entrance of a mechanical system into its critical stage and the detection of pre-failure indicators is the topic of this lecture. Some applications in the restoration of stone monuments are considered also. This is the layout of the lecture. Inevitably, some theoretical preliminaries about non-extensive statistical mechanics and natural time analysis are included. Description of tools used to collect data follows, and a series of experimental protocols are then analyzed. The need to foresee upcoming catastrophic events governs the effort of scientists in a wide range of disciplines. As yet, we are far from the end target. However, in laboratory level, things are promising. Theoretical approaches providing pre-failure indicators are already available. The motive of this study is to comparatively consider the indicators provided by two of these approaches. We can start with some preliminaries concerning non-extensive statistical mechanics and the mysterious entropy. The term entropy was introduced by Clausius, who proposed a familiar equation connecting the change of entropy to the heat transfer and the absolute temperature. He stated that entropy designates the preference of nature for the state in question, and in all the processes which occur in the system, entropy can only grow, never diminish. However, the question, what is entropy, was still open. Only an innate tie with the degradation of usable energy into unusable form was assumed, which from the engineering point of view was equivalent to the generation of unrecoverable heat from any work done by an engine or person. It was then Maxwell who stated that entropy is a distinct physical property of a body and must be zero when completely deprived of heat. Therefore, as heat is transferred from one body to another, the entropy of the system must increase. In any case, the idea of that day was that the absolute value of entropy could not be determined. Soon afterwards, this idea was opposed by Boltzmann, Gibbs, and Planck, who introduced a microscopic understanding of the concept and the respective fundamental equation for entropy, where W is the total number of microscopic configurations, Pi are the probabilities corresponding to these configurations, and K is a constant connecting macroscopic to the microscopic perspective. For equal probabilities, a more familiar form of the entropy equation is obtained that defines what is called Boltzmann-Gibbs entropy. Gibbs, von Neumann, and Shannon discussed further the respective concepts, founding what is known as the Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics, a monumental theory of physics. Boltzmann-Gibbs approach reflects the fundamental insight that the second law of thermodynamics can be understood only in terms of a connection between entropy and probability, and thus the second law is statistical in nature. To be historically fair, Boltzmann-Gibbs equation, carved on Boltzmann's grave, was never wrote down by Boltzmann. It was Planck who first wrote it into the form that became Boltzmann's epitaph. The transition from macroscopic to microscopic perspective was not smooth, especially the exact definition of W was discussed and strongly argued. In the frame of this polemic, Einstein argued that neither Herr Boltzmann nor Herr Planck gave a definition of W. They put formally W equals number of complexions of the state under consideration. After this hard transient period, Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics is quite successfully applied for more than a century, providing solution to numerous problems. Its success is among others a result of its simplicity. As Hilbert states, the total entropy of an ensemble is some function of W, and what remains then is to find that functional relationship which leads to results that agree with experiment. Boltzmann-Gibbs statistical mechanics is based on a series of hypotheses and simplifications, such as ergodicity, well acceptable in classical systems whose microscopic evolution is governed by a positive largest Lyapunov exponent. However, phenomena exist that violate ergodicity. To study such phenomena, a generalization of Boltzmann-Gibbs theory was proposed by Challis based on non-additive entropies. Among them, Charles' entropy is widely used in mechanics. It is defined in terms of the Q logarithmic function shown here. The entropic index Q represents a measure of the non-extensivity of the system, and it accounts for the case of many non-independent, long-range interacting subsystems and memory effects. In most cases, Q reflects multifractality. The violation of the additivity property is obvious. The last term of the equation, shown here, tends to zero only for Q approaching 1. This non-additivity property enables thermodynamical extensivity, at least if both subsystems are very large. Charlie's entropy for a continuous variable x with probability distribution p of x is usually written in the form shown here. In the laboratory, x is any proper mechanical parameter provided by modern sensing techniques. In seismology, x could be the seismic moment, the inter-event time or distance, etc. Optimization of Charlie's entropy is achieved by taking advantage of the obvious normalization condition and the generalized expectation value xq given by Charlie's in terms of the escort probability. For convenience, the q exponential function, which is the inverse of the q logarithmic function, is introduced, providing a flexible form of the probability distribution p of x. The q exponential function is shown here for various values of q. In praxis, this above obtained probability function p of x is used to calculate the cumulative distribution function and to compare the theoretical formulations with the distribution of the variable x. The second theoretical approach providing pre-failure indices is the natural time analysis. The concept was introduced in 2001 by Professor Varotsos. It is considered advantageous because it extracts the maximum possible information for the dynamical evolution of complex systems. Nowadays, it is a valuable tool for the study of disastrous events and the attempt to predict them. Initially, the concept was used in seismology. Gradually, it is applied in a wide variety of disciplines, including mechanics, medicine, physics, economy, etc. Let us consider a time series of n events. The natural time serves as the index for the occurrence of the kth event. It means that the first event is placed at x1 equals to 1 over n, the second at x2 equals to 2 over n, etc. Each event is paired to a quantity qk, which is proportional to the energy. In fact, one ignores the time intervals between consecutive events but preserves their order and energy. For the analysis of the event energy pair, a continuous function f of omega is introduced as it is shown here, where phi is the natural frequency. Usually, f is normalized to phi by dividing f by its f of zero value. Since pk are positive, summing up to unity, they are considered as the probability to observe the kth event at natural time xk. The normalized power spectrum of phi of omega, denoted by p of omega, is reduced to the form shown here, which is approximated knowing its behavior around zero, and is written in a convenient form which for omega approaching zero becomes a function of kappa 1. For systems at criticality, kappa 1 tends to a constant value of 0.07. The second quantity of interest in natural time analysis is the entropy S. Equally important is the entropy under time reversal, defined as it is shown here. When Ek are independent and identically distributed, S approaches the value 0.0966, corresponding to a uniform distribution indicating randomness. Natural time dictates that entrance into critical state demands simultaneous fulfillment of two conditions. First, kappa 1 tends to 0.07 descending from above. Second, the entropy as well as the entropy upon time reversal in natural time domain must be smaller than 0.0966 of a uniform distribution. Now, After these perhaps boring preliminaries, we shall shortly describe the tools used to obtain data from the interior of the specimens structures tested. The acoustic emissions technique is familiar to anyone working for structural health monitoring. It is the most mature and effective tool for monitoring internal damage. The acoustic parameters used to predict criticality include the B or the improved B value, the rate of hits, the energy release rate, the average frequency to rise time per amplitude relation, etc. Recently, an alternative parameter, the F function, was introduced, reflecting the average frequency of occurrence of hits in a time window of n consecutive hits. The F function is based on the inter-event times of a sufficient number of n successive acoustic hits. The mean value of the n inter-event times is calculated for each group of consecutive hits, and its reciprocal defines the F function. Each value F of tau I is paired with the average value of the time instance of the occurrence of the respective n hits. The F function is a useful tool when intense acoustic activity is recorded within a short time interval, and it offers valuable information concerning the time evolution of the acoustic activity just before failure. The value of n is an arbitrary choice, depending on the overall number of hits recorded. Its numerical value does not significantly influence the analysis. The second sensing tool used is the pressure-stimulated currents technique. As it is known, microcracking in quasi-brittle non-metallic materials generates electric charges, constituting electric dipoles. These dipoles produce an electric potential across cracks, and as a result, an electric current flow appears. This is firmly verified by a series of laboratory experiments. These electric currents have been proven useful as precursors of large-scale fracture. Taking advantage of this observation, an experimental technique has been developed for detecting and recording the electric signals emitted due to various types of mechanical loading schemes applied on brittle building materials, like concrete and rocks. The technique is widely known as the pressure-stimulated currents technique, PSC technique. According to the PSC technique, the electric signals are recorded as very weak electric currents of the order of picoampere, with the aid of sensitive electrometers. The sensors are pairs of gold-plated electrodes attached at strategic points. The PSC technique is nowadays widely applied according to various alternatives, providing a flexible and relatively simple tool for monitoring the damage level in mechanically loaded specimens. Next, we describe characteristic protocols during which pre-failure indicators were detected. Protocols with elementary tests are analyzed first. The first protocol deals with the relaxation of PSCs. It is observed experimentally that a steep increase of the stress is responsible for the generation of a PSC. If the stress level is kept constant, the PSC is restored at a lower level. The normalized PSC relaxation function is described by the C-star function shown here. We can see here a sketch of the experimental setup and the PSCs recorded for a typical test with specimens made of amphibolite and marble. Recalling that fracture-related phenomena are characterized by fractality and long-range and memory effects, Valianatos and Triantis suggested that the relaxation of PSC should be described using Challis Q exponential function, as it is shown here. We can see in this slide the normalized PSC relaxation function, Xi star, versus the time-to-failure parameter for amphibolite and marble, together with the respective Q exponential fitting curves. It is clear that the fitting is more than satisfactory almost for the whole duration of the tests. During the whole procedure, Q exceeds 1. It increases towards a maximum around 1.45. After a stress level exceeding 85% of the material strength, Q starts decreasing. Recalling that Q greater than 1 indicates subadditivity, it is concluded that initially the processes taking place are increasingly subadditive, manifesting strong influence of the pre-existing status of the specimen to its next one. On the other hand, the drop of Q manifest initiation of dynamic processes that take place as failure approaches, namely when size effect and microstructure become dominant. Along the same lines, both TAF-Q parameter and the PSC background level increase smoothly up to stress levels equal to about 85% of the material strength. Then they start increasing quite steeply. Identical conclusions were drawn by Valianatos and Sammons from a study regarding a definitely different scale level, that of mega earthquakes. They concluded that, as we approach the Sumatran mega event, a power law starts to describe the seismic moment distribution, and the entropic index deviates from unity, approaching a value 1.42. The criticality limit of Q was indicated also by Stavrakas et al. Their protocol included repetitive loading-unloading loops at gradually higher levels on cement mortar beams under three-point bending. The inter-event times was the parameter of the analysis conducted according to the NESM approach. The cumulative probability functions were plotted and then the experimental data were fitted using the Q exponential function as it is seen in the slide. Stavrakas et al. Concluded that the Q value for each loading and unloading loop increases gradually, approaching the previously mentioned value of 1.42. Obviously, a thinner resolution of the data in terms of the time to failure parameter is necessary in order to gain a thorough insight to what happens during the very last load levels before fracture. The next protocol considered deals with monotonic instead of repetitive loading schemes. Specimens of various geometries made of either marble or cement mortar were loaded monotonically under various loading schemes up to fracture. The inter-event time was chosen as the variable X of the NESM analysis and the original time series, after being divided into a proper number of successive groups, was transformed to the respective inter-event time series. Again, the NESM approach was applied and the normalized cumulative distribution was plotted for each group. The acoustic emission data were fitted by a Q exponential function and the entropic indices Q and Vita Q were calculated for each group. For the normalized cumulative distribution, the Q exponential distribution proposed by Valianatos et al. Was adopted. We can see here sketches of the specimens tested. Typical distributions of the acoustic emission amplitudes and the inter-event times for a characteristic specimen of the circular semi-ring class is seen here versus time to failure. Each color corresponds to one of the groups used to calculate the corresponding inter-event times. The cumulative distribution functions of the inter-event times of each group, along with the corresponding Q exponential fitting curves for a typical notched beam-shaped specimen, can be seen in this slide. Taking advantage of the fitting procedure, Q was calculated for each data group. Its evolution versus the average time to failure is seen in these figures for beam-shaped specimens, either notched or intact under bending. It is concluded that also for this protocol, a systematic relationship between Q and load exists. Q increases with increasing load until load levels around 90% of the strength, where the entropic index Q attains a maximum value around 1.45. Then a steep decrease of Q is observed. Another parameter used in the NESM frame is the inter-event distance, according to an idea of Abe and Suzuki, who studied time and space distances between earthquakes. They found that the cumulative distributions of the time and space distances between consecutive earthquakes obey the modified Zipf-Mandelbrot law, characterized by Q exponential distributions, with Q lower than 1 for the inter-event distances and greater than 1 for the inter-event times. This idea was applied in a rich laboratory protocol, and the normalized CDF of the inter-event times and the inter-event distances were again assumed to be described by Q exponential functions. After proper curve fitting, the Q entropic indices for the inter-event times and the inter-event distances were calculated. Exactly as it was predicted by Abe and Suzuki for the earthquake's time series, the sum of the two entropic indices is equal to 2 with negligible scattering. Let us us now proceed to an application in terms of natural time. The protocol included uniaxial tensile loading of double edged notched plates made of Dionysus marble. Special attention was paid to the proper alignment of the specimens. A typical specimen well tested is shown here. From the mechanics of materials point of view, the relation of the load with the notch mouth opening displacement is of crucial importance. We can see in this slide characteristic curves for two specimens with notch length equal to 6 and 8 mm together with the respective stress displacement curves and the stress NMOD ones. It is to be highlighted that often the response of the two notches is different due to the nature of the Dionysus marble, which is transversely isotropic, and its anisotropy directions do not exactly coincide with the specimen's axis. As a result, the two tips do not enter simultaneously into their critical stage. We can see here the projection of the temporal evolution of the rise time per amplitude from the conventional time domain to the natural one. Following Varrochos, we plot the normalized power spectrum P of phi on a heat-by-heat basis. A sequence of P of phi plots for a typical specimen is shown here. It is clear that the P of phi curve approaches the critical one from below and coincidence happens at the 230th heat. To avoid plotting a huge number of P of phi graphs, the variance of P of phi kappa 1 is plotted instead. It becomes then possible to plot in the same graph the evolution of both entropies and kappa 1 and easily check whether both conditions are simultaneously fulfilled. As a next step, it is very interesting and crucial to comparatively consider various criticality indices as they are obtained from different theoretical approaches. In this direction, another dense specimen is considered from a series of alternative points of view. The stress strain response at the center of the specimen and at the crown of the notch is shown here. You can see the huge difference due to the process zone developed around the notch's crown. On the other hand, the low time curve is almost perfectly linear, shadowing critical information and rendering its value very limited. Starting from, let us say, traditional approaches, we plotted here the temporal evolution of the familiar improved B-value in terms of the time-to-failure parameter, as we are mainly interested to what happens during the very last loading steps. The plot offers an index of criticality, onset of rapid decrease towards a value equal to 1 at about 14 seconds before fracture. The criticality index, as it is provided by the PSC, onset of rapid increase of the electric current recorded, appears at about 16 seconds before fracture. Natural time analysis reveals its index of criticality at the 237th heat, which was recorded at the time instant 2987 seconds, or 21 seconds before fracture. On the same slide, we have plotted the time evolution of the entropic index Q. Assuming, as it was previously discussed, that the onset of decreasing of the Q values corresponds to entrance into critical stage, the criticality index provided by NESP appears about 7 seconds before macroscopic fracture. Plotting in the same graph all four pre-failure indices discussed, it is seen that, in spite of the completely different theoretical basis of each one of them and the different nature of the parameters considered, all four indices lie within a rather narrow time interval, ranging from 7 to 21 seconds. The fact that various techniques provide quite comparable results is very encouraging, suggesting further research in the direction of even finer resolution of the data. Encouraged by the above results, we attempt now the next step, to analyze data obtained from protocols with more complex specimens resembling structural elements of stone monuments. In the first protocol, fractured epistyles restored with layers of titanium bars were submitted to bending. The protocol is part of a project implemented for the restoration of the Parthenon Temple on the Athenian Acropolis. A copy of an epistyle fractured into two asymmetrical parts along an inclined plane was tested. It was restored using three pairs of titanium bars driven in pre-drilled holes filled with cement paste. The three materials complex obtained, marble, cement paste, titanium, rendered the analysis quite challenging. The most important quantities from the engineering point of view are the deflection and the midsection of the epistyle and the false opening. Their temporal evolution is shown in this slide together with the respective evolution of the overall load and that of the PSC. The peak of the PSC at the instant of the load drop is to be definitely highlighted, and this is in excellent agreement with the time instant of the transient time interval at which the deflection and the false opening are passing from the area of smooth, almost negligible increase to that of the abrupt, almost exponential one. Interesting conclusions were drawn also from the plot of the load versus the false opening in juxtaposition to the respective evolution of the PSC and from the plot of the load and the cumulative acoustic emission energy versus the false opening. Clearly, critical events appear while the false opening is less than 0.5 mm. The analysis of the experimental data in terms of the temporal evolution of the F function, that of the NESM, namely Q index, and that of the PSC, always in juxtaposition to the load induced, are shown in this slide comparatively. All three approaches indicate that at the time instant of about 1000 seconds, the behavior of the respective parameters changes drastically. Special attention must be paid to the behavior of the Q index, which, contrary to what was observed in elementary tests and specimens made of a single material, it decreases, and only when we approach the catastrophic fracture, it starts increasing. Another structural protocol is the shear loading of interconnected epistyles. Ancient stone masons used eye-shaped metallic elements to keep the epistyles in place. Under specific conditions, for example specific types of seismic excitations, the connections suffer from shear and quite often they fail. We can see here a typical specimen. It consists of two marble blocks, a cubic and a gamma-shaped one, connected with an eye-shaped titanium connector placed in grooves sculptured on the blocks and covered with cementitious material. According to the protocol, the cubic block is rigidly clamped on the loading frame, while the gamma-shaped one is loaded so that it moves parallel to itself within the interfacial plane, inducing a pure shear loading scheme on the connection. One can see in this slide the analysis of the experimental data, again as previously, in terms of the temporal evolution of the N function, that of the NESM and that of the PSC, always in juxtaposition to the load induced. The analysis of the data of the specific protocol is still in progress. However, one should highlight the almost identical to that observed during the bending protocol behavior of the Q index. Its values are initially decreasing, and a little before fracture, they start increasing. Although things appear encouraging, there are unfortunately quite a few open issues. Some of them are highlighted in this last section. While applying concepts of NESM, different trends of Q values are reported for different materials. The asymptotic value of Q depends strongly on the material. For specimens made of two or more materials, Q depends on the nature of each constituent, rendering deduction of definite conclusions about criticality shaky. Moreover, deviations of the fitting curves from the experimental points are observed at the tails of the CDFs, which correspond to long times, delta TAF, and long distances, delta R. The number of the data points in this tail region is usually relatively small for both CDFs, however, further detailed analysis is suggested. In addition, it has been observed that natural time analysis provides different instants for the entrance to criticality, depending on the position of the acoustic emission sensor, the data of which are analyzed. Furthermore, in case of multiple critical areas, areas where crack initiation is expected, it is possible that natural time analysis indicates that criticality is attained later at the region from which fracture started. Concluding, it can be said that in spite of the intensive research, a definite answer to the problem is not as yet available for in-field applications. In the laboratory, things are better. Pre-failure indicators do exist and are detectable. However, Even in the laboratory scale, there are still open issues that must be addressed before definite suggestions are provided.